specifically. It's in finance committee mode. The purpose of this finance committee is to consider the item shown on the schedule to the appropriation financial years 2022 and 2023 bill 2021. Given that the number of members of parliament is 19, the quorum for finance committee is 10 members, excluding the chairperson of the committee. The committee is now quorate, and we can proceed with the meeting. Honorable members, I'm going to ask, and I'm going to appeal that they, when asking the questions, none of the long preambles. I know sometimes it's temptation or it's tempted, but we can get more questions answered if we avoid the long speeches. So I'm going to ask members to be prompt. And one of the things I'm going to say to members right now, which is something that I've never been done in finance committee before, but I think it's important to reestablish, I guess, the seriousness of the business that we're doing, is that for this year, we'll be asking every witness to basically be to be giving their testimony on the oath. I have discussed this with my colleagues already, and as much as this may be something that may probably benefit the opposition to make sure that no one comes down here and pretty much mislead them, I think it goes to show the seriousness of this. So we want anyone to be truthful as possible. If you don't know, you don't know. Don't try to guess the answer. You know what I mean? That was one of the things I found very frustrating when I was previously on the other side, and I said if I was ever in a position to do something about it, I would. So this is one of the things that I think the opposition members would actually welcome, to make sure from that standpoint. The government members are already familiar with the budget. We have already had our questions and everything else, but it is important that for the public that they be given the truth at all times. So, and so I'll just leave it at that. One of the things I just, a little bit more housekeeping, is that we'll go through the bills. You would have received a separate page that was prepared by the Minister of Finance that shows the schedule, but on the far right, it gives you the page numbers that you can refer to. That'll make it much easier to go along with in terms of getting more details that you may wish. And as usual, we can either vote for item on an individual basis, or we can vote for items in block. That is up, again, to members, mostly on the opposition side. So in that standpoint, or in that vein, the usual question I will ask is that, you know, in accordance with Standing Order 64.3, I shall ask members' approval for a particular item by posing a question. All those in favor of item so-so and so, standing part of the schedule to the bill, please say aye, and against, no. So just wanted to just put that out. I know all of you are veterans now to this, so we should be fine. So with that said, we will start with the Ministry of Tourism first. And for the revised schedule that has been provided to members, it starts on page 21. And then you can see in the planning estimate, the reference pages is starting from roughly 180 onwards. That will have more information there. So with that said, I'm going to start with DAT 1. Advice and support to the Minister of Tourism and Transport. For the financial year 2022, the appropriation amount is $2,310,950. And for 2023, $2,314,165. Are there any questions? Okay, seeing that there are no questions, I'll ask all those in favor of DAT 1, advice and support to the Minister of Tourism and Transport, $2,310,950 in 2022, $2,304,165 in 2023. Please say aye.
Aye.
Against, no. The ayes have it. Moving on to DAT 14, public transport services, for 2022, $901,978. For 2023, $904,891. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Honorable Deputy Leader of the Opposition, Member Georgetown North.
Mr. Chairman, I wonder if the Minister could give us some insight as to what the plans are for public transport, whether this includes any sort of mass public transport studies or any future plans to streamline and to create efficiencies within the public transport.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And through you, Mr. Chair, I want to thank the member for the question, and good morning to all members of the House and all those who are visiting. To answer the member's question, as he heard in my budget contribution, the overall plan for transport for these 2 years is mainly focused on research and analysis of what's the best practices that we can use to create efficiencies with the public transport. A lot of the next year and a half until the next budget will be focused on legislative changes as we do a report on what ways we can strengthen the laws, because much of the problems that we're having in transport relate to inappropriate practices within the transport offerings. I intend to travel to some of the neighboring Caribbean islands that have efficient, eco-friendly bus transport, and I want to meet with some other members of parliament in the other jurisdictions to see what corresponding legislation that they have that can help us tailor-make what we may bring to this parliament. I intend to also have a committee formed for the necessary research for the reform. As you know, we are limited in our cash amounts for these first 2 years, and hence the reason there hasn't been a large portion of money is put aside for any fundamental changes. So these 2 years will be focused on the legislative arm and the regulatory arm and the enforcement arm. In the next budget, we hope that the country's finances is in a better position to allocate the necessary monies for improvements. For example, one of the hopes is to have a national public transport system that is governed by the Cayman Islands government in partnership with private sector. But that may go as far as ordering major buses and the like. But we will do that in the next budget. For now, we're going to focus on the organizational elements of the transport system. And I must say, Mr. Chairman, focusing on the not the taxi and tour operations, but more so the public transportation that the average person takes every day.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. Member for Georgetown North.
Mr. Chairman, can the minister say, and I apologize, I was listening intently, but I didn't hear whether or not there were any plans within this next 2 years to do any forms of studies on what he said that you would be visiting other Caribbean islands to see what they're doing, but are we carrying out? There were plans, and I think even we've got as far as an RFP being prepared to do a mass public transport study. Is that part of the 2 years of research, or is that we're looking for 3 years down the road?
Minister Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you, the simple answer is yes. We have no intentions of breaking down what was already there, but to follow through. If the minister is saying that there was plans for studies, we would definitely have to work with whatever was already collected, analyze that, and add more to it if necessary based on the results of those studies. So the simple answer is yes.
Member for Georgetown North.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank the Honourable Minister for that response. I will say to him that the work that had been done under the Ministry of my ministry, which was it was a joint ministerial effort between my ministry and Minister of Tourism, but it was being driven by my ministry. So there may be some residual overflow there. I think it is important if there is, and perhaps in the funding for the Ministry of Sustainability, perhaps there might be some efforts in there as well, because we, and relevant to tourism, as we see tourism starting to return And we saw it this week in the type of traffic, the increase in traffic that we saw on our roads just with a few tourists in Ireland, a few returning residents. When we get back to the numbers that we used to have, I think it's going to be important to have proper public transport in place, and as well as, and we'll get to that later on, things like the complete streets where we make it safe to encourage people to ride bicycles and scooters and things. Otherwise, we're all going to be sitting in traffic for weeks. I do have another question.
Sure. Member for Joshua North.
Can the ministers say whether or not there are any... Can the ministers say whether or not they are issuing new public bus licenses and taxi licenses?
Minister of Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. At this particular moment, with the low levels of tourism, I'm not of the view for the board to be issuing any more new license. All that's going to do is add more pressure to those who are in the industry now. Obviously, the numbers that were granted for tour and taxi operators before was based on the levels of persons available to take those tours and those taxes, and we're not even close to that yet. So to add more new ones onto that would only just make a smaller piece of the pie for the current ones. So until we see the numbers start to stabilize, which we'll continue to monitor that every other month, and then we go from there, and the board can direct whether or not they think it's timely on information given, whether or not they should start adding more taxi license to it, or tour licenses.
Member for Georgetown North.
Thank you. Thank the minister for the response. My final question is, area of questioning, is on the public buses. It has been an issue ongoing where some routes are not as profitable as others. Some bus drivers would say some routes are not sustainable whatsoever. Are there plans to help subsidize those routes that may not be profitable for the tour operators, for the bus drivers? And B, is there any consideration for a policy where if a person is operating on a route that is known not to be as busy as the others, and for over a period of time, perhaps on a first-come, first-served basis, and a slot opens up on one of the more successful routes, is there a policy in place that would allow persons to move into the more profitable routes?
Minister of Tourism and Transport.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I thank the member for the Deputy Leader of Opposition for that question, because that's exactly the line of thinking the minister myself has, because seems to be no true logic as to the way it's allocated. Hence the reason for the necessary overview of how transport works. To be honest with you, this problem has been going on now for quite some time, not only in this administration, where some routes don't make that like the others. So why not rotate the members? So if you work 1 month in a good profit-making route, then the next month you go to one that is not so profitable. But again, I'm not of the mind to change very much, because if you change it in the market that it is now without being sure of exactly how the effect is going to do, you may end up making it worse. Though I recognize that those problems are there, it doesn't make sense to try to change it up until you understand the flow of things. And that is constantly changing, because if you were to keep the numbers exactly what they are now, you can probably fix the problem. But adding another 5,000 people to the mix, then you have a totally different problem all over again. So I agree with you. That's one of the things I'm considering outside of the overhaul itself, which is having bus routes being switched amongst bus drivers. But we have to look at that very carefully, because as you know, bus drivers get accustomed to their routes. They know the spots where people live, where they normally get picked up, and you get familiar with that. So before I agree with that suggestion, I want to have a deeper conversation with the stakeholders, the bus drivers themselves, and see how that would be played out. But that would allow more fair opportunity for the bus drivers to make a profit.
Member for Georgetown North.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank the minister for the response. And I'll just say that in my discussions with some of them, it would appear that some people are willing to do their time, as in a sense, but when the opportunities arise for them to move to a more profitable route, they would like that opportunity. And there's also the concern that perhaps the routes are not being equitably distributed between those persons who have multiple vehicles and independents. So I have no answers for you, but it's something that I do think needs addressing. So thank you.
Member for Cayman Brack West. Okay.
Thank you for recognizing me. That was my question as well. It was extremely well answered by the minister. My question was going to be, is there a short-term strategy? And you've explained it, so thank you for that.
Thank you very much. And I'll take the vote. DAT 14, Public Transport Services, for financial year 2022, $901,978. And for the year 2023, $904,891. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Against, no? The ayes have it. Colleagues, moving on to DAT 17, Tourism Support, Training, Promotional, and Advertisement Activities. For the financial year 2022, the amount is $24,614,891. And for the financial year 2023, the amount is $25,256,784. Are there any questions? Honorable Member for Cayman Brack West.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I recognize that we haven't had tourism in a while, so this is a very important line item here of reestablishing ourselves. One of the questions that we get quite often is, under this line item, provide tourist accommodation inspections and licensing. There seems to be some gray areas in inspections and licensing. Maybe the minister could bring us up to date as far as what the charges are. Do we pay tourism tax now for the inspection, hotel licensing fees? Where are we with that for the community and the tourism sector?
Honorable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm going to ask my chief officer to come and help support with the answer, but to give him a preliminary before the chief officer takes the mic. Right now, we are examining the best ways of collection, as we think the system of collection of those revenues that belong to the Treasury or through the Department of Tourism isn't done in the best way possible. But it's difficult to reform and address that in a time of the pandemic when everybody is, right now we just want to make sure that they can actually have clients rather than asking them about the monies that they owe the government that they're not even making. So that's not a top priority. As you have heard from the ministry, our announcement for not charging room tax until the start of the new year, in efforts to continue to help the industry. So I think it was a good thing that my colleague supported the ministry to not charge them any fees at all over the Christmas period. And we're hoping that that will be a bit of a rebate for them to make some money throughout this period, and then the government can start collecting tax in the new year. But as per the fee structure, that may have answered your questions. If you have anything specific more, I'd be happy to assist.
Thank you for that. The time period you say will end at the end of this year, 2021. Is there a consideration to review this based on how tourism recovers in this country? The example being, as you've given, if you're not making money and you're trying to stay on board, if first quarter doesn't return the results that we all hope it will, can you review and see if you're going to come back to the industry and say we're going to work with you?
Honorable Minister of Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Of course, the PAC administration is going to do everything it possibly can to support the business community, particularly that in tourism. But we have to be mindful that the government has to earn its revenues to pay the bills. I mean, your leader of opposition quite succinctly highlighted the dangers of our not collecting enough revenue. So we're going to have to balance that. But obviously, if we see that things are not moving as fast as we hoped, Even though I'm very confident things will do so based on the numbers and the figures over the last 3 weeks, we will examine that. That's part of responsible government, and my team will support me on that. So the simple answer is yes, we would review, but there's no reason that we think that those numbers will not reach the projections that we predict.
Honourable Member Cayman Brackwest.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Can I ask another question?
Absolutely, this is why we're here.
I think we can move on into the overall vote. And if I assume or read how this is laid out, this actually helps us put together our strategy of how we're going to recover and how we're going to bring the tourism numbers back to the country. The example being in this next year, as you put together the recovery guideline and graph, so to speak, the country enjoys one of the highest return rates of guests in the region. Just a little bit less than 50% of people that come will return. So my question is, when you have put together the strategy, has the return guests been included? And I give you the example that if we want to, we did 520,000 in 2019, and we hope to do 220 or 210,000 as you recover the first year back. The truth is that if the marketing is done correctly, the return guests should be waiting to come back. I just wanted to get an overview of the strategy of how we're looking at, there should be a division between return, new, high net worth, 3-4 stars.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Forgive me if I don't answer the question specifically, because there's a lot in that. But I think you're just basically asking us how we plan to market and who we hope to get back to the country. As you have said, 50% of the people that normally travel here will want to come back. And our projections are 40% of the overall numbers from 2019. So you're talking about 20%, 50% of 40%, which would be 20%, will be returning passengers. You may see that a substantial amount of our monies for this allocation is in respect to promotional and advertising activities, which has, as I highlighted in my budget contribution, will be focused on high net worth individuals and the more affluent persons. So though our projections are that we're not gonna get past 40%, and we hope that we do, that those other 20,000 people that does come will spend more money. So ultimately it would be the same equivalent and revenue for the country and the economy and businesses and employment to be way past the 40%. So we're looking at it more of about quality rather than the quantity. So in effect, the 40% of this administration would be more of a 60% of the last approach to tourism, if that answers your question.
Honourable Member Cayman Brackwest.
Thank you. I thank the Minister. In 2018 and 2019, we enjoyed the highest average daily rate spent. So quality has always been, for stayover visitors, a target. The issue of how this money is broken down and markets that it's going to be spent. In your contribution, you talked about diversification of your market. Do you know that by percentages?
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
I don't have that off the top of my head, but I'll ask my Director of Tourism to assist if she has that available.
Sorry, you can pull that, and it's right on, yeah.
Go. I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give this honorable parliament shall be with truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Thank you.
Madam Director, thank you very much. When answering the first question, you can just state your name and title in for the record, please. Thank you.
Good morning, Rosa Harris, Director of Tourism. Thank you for the question. Our target for 2022 is 201,702 passengers. The most difficult aspect of reopening has been securing air seats into the destination. And because we came on later in the winter season, many of the airlines are gauging their global employee shortages and returning to destinations. But we're confident that tourism will deliver 40% in 2022. Our relationships are prioritized with the travel trade. These are the persons that sell the destination, travel agents and wholesalers. Our budget has been reduced slightly. However, we still feel confident that the 40% is very achievable in 2022. The second relationship that's key to achieving this goal is our relationship with the airlines. We have shifting going on because Q1 is impacted by the most recent announcement of the new variant. So ongoing COVID and travel confidence will be directly associated in how it impacts travel decisions moving forward. To speak to the member's question about the return rate, we do have a very high return rate and we do have a strong demand to get to the destination. But as we move into the holiday period over the next 3 weeks, getting to the Cayman Islands, in truth, is a difficult task, finding an available seat. But this will start to recover mid-February with the return of American Airlines from two of their hubs, Miami and Charlotte. We also have the return of WestJet on the 16th of this month, and Cayman Airways returning two important hubs for us as well in December. But it will be a month-to-month monitoring and being very connected with our tourism hoteliers, condo, guest house, and villa property owners. One, to ensure that everybody understands what they have to do to apply to gain approval to travel to Cayman. And those travel requirements can change because of the impact of COVID. But also, in most recent weeks, we've had connections with the accommodation sector and our national airline, Cayman Airways, to ensure that we prioritized the scheduling for the festive season and for the hoteliers to fill those seats for Cayman Airways. So the strategy is to ensure that we are fully connected with the distribution channel. Those who sell the Cayman Islands and those who fly to the Cayman Islands. And that will be the sweet spot for success in the coming year, sir.
Honorable Member for Cayman Brackwest.
Thank you. I just want to say to Madam Director that myself and opposition understand and know that the Department of Tourism is the gold standard. You're fabulous with the work you've done and the work you've done through pandemic. We understand that and we appreciate everything you and your team do. In the previous debate, it was mentioned that our diversification was looking at South America, Central America, and other places besides the United States. Our concern over on this side is that core market for us should be the United States and Canada. You have almost 400 million people and we're looking for 500,000 over a couple of years out of slicing that up. And we're also looking at understanding how we make it as easy as possible for them to get there, which is what you're struggling with now. I think that when it's looked at and what you're doing and what's identified here, it's evident that we are attacking our core market, North America, going back to where we get the most people
and where we can dictate and look at how we market to high net worth individuals, because basically we have the information of how we can attract them digitally and know what their income is in high net worth individual areas or areas of high dollar Northeast United States. So what I'm hearing from you is then our core market continues to be our strategy. We continue to look for high net worth individuals. We understand that until children are allowed to travel, that we're going to miss the multi-generational tourists that's bread and butter for this economy and this tourism product. And you will continue to try to match the person who's coming to the seat they sit in, to the hotel room they stay in, to the attractions that they visit. One swift flow. That's what you said.
Yes, sir, that's what I said. And I thank you for mentioning one really big piece of information that I may have neglected to share. DOT has collected information over the years that we've recorded visitation from our core markets. We know right down to the neighborhood and which house we should place TV to and which house we can skip, because their preferences and interests are very different. Our investment of this promotion, these promotional dollars, will shift from very traditional print, radio, into a full digital mode. And the reason for that is because of COVID, because it changes so often, we have to be able to change our investment with very little notice, and to be able to and place our dollars in longer lead mediums, meaning print or others that take a long time to place. Mm-hmm. For example, print has a 3-month lead time. If I wanted to place an ad, I would have to place it now for 3 months from now. Most of our monies will go into television that can address the household. It's called addressable TV. It takes your viewing profile. It can tell me the channels that you love, whether you love channels like hot weather destinations, whether you like to fly, or you look at luxury cars or luxury goods, which tells me the type of spender that you are. And we can place the Cayman Islands ad in that household and skip your neighbor who's into hunting and probably would not come to the Cayman Islands. So you're very accurate in saying that data will drive the strategy. The tourism data that we collected up to, well, we still collect it, but of course, visitation has been scaled since reopening, would have given us interests, meaning the exit survey gives us interests of what they want to do on island. And the embarkation, disembarkation card captures their zip code. And with that data that we get from CBC, it is sanitized, and we look at it by how we invest our dollars. That is for all source markets, so USA, Canada, and the UK. I understand that there may be concern about possibly moving away from core markets, but as the old saying goes, you can't put all of your eggs in one basket. And diversification is the key to flattening seasonality. The up and down that we see in tourism over the course of a year, even now with 2020 data being on a very low level for 2020, we had the first 3 months, which were strong, and then it tapered off. But it follows the exact same track when you look at it as a line graph. So our seasonality, even though we have been closed for 20 months, follows the same pattern, which means we have the same goal of ensuring we can bring those slower months up to higher performing months. And diversification, meaning the times of year Latin America has winter and South America has winter, is opposite. to our core markets, where you, when Europeans want to travel and how long they want to travel for, adds to the visitor spend and the value of the visitor. So being able to expand our reach into Europe and the Latin America countries are equally important as our core markets.
Honourable Member for Cayman Brack West.
Thank you. I thank her for the answer. Very well done. So just so I can understand this, the core market continues to be what we've done before, what we've driven forward, what has paid dividends and brought a lot of people here. September, October, November, which is a switch in the season for Chile and Argentina, would be viewed as an opportunity that we would try to bring people in that slower part of the season for high spend.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
So I don't think this is, maybe it's a Cayman Airways question of, are we looking at gateways and connectivity out of that area to build a core around and a hub?
I would say that currently we have been charged to provide recommendations on the current service for Cayman Airways and look at short to medium range destinations. We are in the final stages of our recommendation from the Honorable Minister of Tourism, which we'll present to him, I guess, after Finance Committee has concluded. But as a member of the Cayman Airways Board, we have also shared our intent to share this data with the board so that their commercial committee can also examine opportunities. What I would say is any decision that we make, certainly we'd be looking at profitability and our ability to fill the plane. Is that destination a critical destination, or is it just a nice to have? And we've been able to identify through our ED card data, so that zip code data, we can tell you, and Sabre data, we can tell you, just like in the case of Denver, how many people had to connect and did not have a direct service to the Cayman Islands. And there's about 7 US cities where there is priority for Cayman Airways to consider new routes.
Honourable Member for Cayman Brack West.
Thank you very much. I think the last question, there's probably another place to ask about how the overview fits into Cayman Brack and Little Cayman with marketing and domestic. Dream in Cayman is still our baby and still, after pandemic, going to be rolled out again.
Director.
Thank you. Thank you for the question. Dream in Cayman, as we speak, we're preparing for our 2.0 shoot. The Cayman Islands can witness this coming week into 2 weeks, production crews across all three islands, sorry, two islands, Grand Cayman and Little Cayman. We have an Owen Island feature this year. In the first shoot, it was Cayman Brack and the Bluff. But we do have our creative agency, along with team members from our New York team on the ground, shooting video this round. The last round, we only got still shots, which was mainly for print or billboard or online display. So we'll be happy to transition our investment from our budget from just 7 executions and expanding the suite of Dream in Cayman to digital video, which will give us versatility for our television marketing as well. As for connectivity, I know that the direct service through Cayman Airways continues to Cayman Brack, and the consideration is always for connectivity in Grand Cayman to ensure that passengers can be onward to Little Cayman or Cayman Brack.
Honourable Member for Cayman Brack West.
Thank you. I'd just like to thank the director for her answers and job well done. Thank the minister for allowing her to answer those questions. Thank you.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Mr. Chair, through you, thank the elected member for Cayman Brack West. And As you know, this administration is willing to work with the opposition, and therefore, when the Department of Tourism is ready to present those strategic data analysis about the South American market or any other market, I'd be happy to have you involved in that. You've been in the game a long time and still trust your guidance and advice. So I'll just add some other points that were highlighted for your knowledge. Obviously, safety has become a big issue in respect to printed media from connectivity of picking up print and the like. So that's one of the main studies have shown that online media is not only the new way forward for the next generation, but it also has COVID-19 concerns. And as you heard the director say, it allows us to move our marketing quicker than the three-month period. You also highlighted the fact that the circumstances with children not being able to be vaccinated is a key factor in our way moving forward. And we hope that we can get the necessary medical advice to the cabinet and to the caucus that allow us to put in provisions to allow families back. But obviously, we it's unfair sometimes when you're accused of not keeping the country safe, but then also say, you know, we're not allowing kids and families to come. And it's not an easy balance to do, but safety has to be the top priority. We're just hoping that there will be enough medical breakthroughs to allow us to invite all the families, because we're a family jurisdiction. Also to say that South America may sometimes seem as not a jurisdiction that is attractive, but there is a large percentage of affluent visitors there in the South American markets. And with the fleet that was purchased under your tenure, I think it allows us a lot of efficiencies from a distance, from cost savings in fuel, and more rounds. So that fleet will be able to do a whole lot more while still doing the core things that were there before that was profitable to us, like the American market.
Honourable Member Cayman Brackwest.
Yeah, I want to thank the Minister for that. I think that what gave me comfort this morning is the way forward is that you're not in any way moving away from core market. You're strengthening how we get high net worth individuals and looking for the months that are the valleys to bring them back up toward the peaks. And I thought it was very well explained by the director. I think the other part of why I mentioned the issue of children and them being allowed to come is because our success was brought on by an under-promise and an over-delivery for tourism when they came. And it was brought on by making it easy for them to get here. When you compare us to any other destination, you can see the sophistication and the level of confidence and compliance of how we get people here, which is continuing. So I mentioned that because if we're looking now, and we talked about some of the burden and costs that tourism operators have going into first quarter, first quarter is going to be hard again because of the multi-generational tourists that we depend on. And you well know that if you bring the child, the parent, and the grandparent's heart is, I'll buy anything for them while I'm here. So it's the under-promise, over-deliver is for us not to think that we're targeting them, but the first quarter is not going to be a big recovery period for that. And it'll be second, third quarter if we are extremely fortunate. So that was my only point, but thank you.
Any other questions for the Honorable Minister? If not, I'll put it to the vote. All those in favor of DAT 17, tourism support, training, promotional, and advertising activities in the amount of $24,614,891 in 2022, and $25,356,784 in 2023, please say aye.
Aye.
Against, no. The ayes have it. Moving on now to CAL 1, Strategic Domestic Air Services, in the amount of $3,134,000 in 2022, and $3,134,000 in 2023. Are there any questions?
Mr. Chairman, do you mind taking those two in a block vote? Because I know that the questions are probably going to be around the same area for both. So if that's okay with the opposition.
Block vote of what? Sure. I don't have any problem with that.
Yes, so we will have the questions then both for Kyle 1 and Kyle 2 be basically done simultaneously and then voted on simultaneously. Yeah. Are there any questions for Kyle 1 or Kyle 2?
Mr. Chair, just before the member asks that question, I was wondering if he was okay with taking EI 1 as well as a part of that block vote because it's associated with Cayman Airways Limited.
You're asking for a block vote on Cal 1?
Cal 1, Cal
2, 2,
and EI 1.
Which one is it? Mr. Chairman, through you to the minister, that's fine. We can wrap it all together and then we can free up some very knowledgeable expertise that's here to help answer questions.
Pardon, that's fine. So just a bit of house cleaning then. So the vote that I'm going to be asking, which I'm going to put out there now, we'll be looking at Kyle 1 Strategic Domestic Air Services in the amount of $3,134,000 in 2022. $3,134,000 in 2023. Also, Cal 2, Strategic Tourism Regional Core Services, $15,435,000 in 2022, $15,435,000 in 2023. And EI 1, Cayman Airways Limited, $9,100,000 in 2022, and $9,100,000 in 2023. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Member for Cayman Brockwest.
Thank you. I would ask the minister if he could just give us a quick overview on the domestic air service.
Minister of Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank the member for Cayman Brockwest for the question. Not much has changed since the last administration in respect to it. Outside the fact that we're now reopening and we will continue to have that air service to Kim and Brack. Obviously, you know, we're focusing heavily on trying to have a more tourism to Kim and Brack with island hopping. So we're hoping that the number of flights to Kim and Brack will increase. I must say that I'm concerned about the use of some of the smaller aircrafts. We want to eventually try to move away from the twin auto, the twin autos are the smaller planes, if my memory serves me correct. Sorry, my apologies, the Saabs. But that cannot happen anytime soon until we have the matter with the Little Cayman Airport rectified. But in respect to continued travel to Cayman Brac, we intend to service Cayman Brac not only from a tourism perspective, but a local transportation between Cayman Brac and Grand Cayman as usual. So besides that, in respect to the inter-island travel, it's still going to be the same.
Honourable Member for Cayman Brac West.
I thank the Minister for that. What has been presented here is basically the same amount of money that was in 2021 budget. And truth is that the pandemic didn't affect the international, the pandemic didn't affect the amount of flights into Cayman Brac, if anything, or Little Cayman, if anything, it at the peak of it had more demand than less demand. The comfort from this is that so what we have now, we are funded, that we don't have to worry. We would be prepared to make sure that we support enough funding in this budget that we don't get 6 months from now calls that flights can't be put in because the funding is not there for Cayman Brac or Little Cayman. So we for Cayman Brac and Little Cayman to continue in the road ahead, which they have gained some ground, and as you well know, it's, both islands are fabulous places to be, but are totally dependent on airlift. So if airlift is not consistent and continues to be improved like it has been, then we have problems. So that we're, my question today is to just make sure that you're satisfied that this will continue to give us the demand we need.
Honorable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think the question was to ensure that the same level of this year will happen next year, and if the funding is available for it. I can confirm that the funding for the appropriate amount of travel to Cayman Brac is available, but we have to recognize the amount of travel to Cayman Brac over this year may not be exactly the same, because when the borders were closed, inter-island travel was a lot higher. I'm very happy to see that a lot of people were doing staycations in Cayman Brac. Now, as former minister, you would know that there's two different types of travel to Cayman Brac and Little Cayman, one for vacation purposes and one for local travel. Now, we don't know what the figures are going to say in respect to whether there's going to be a dip in persons traveling to Cayman Brac for staycations. I hope that's not the case, because Cayman Brac is an amazing place, and Little Cayman, for you to do your staycations and spending money at home is always better. But we don't know what the numbers will be like now that the flights are available to go to other jurisdictions. But we will continue to support that if the need is there. Now, in respect to the other flights that are necessary for business and continued travel, just for local purposes and family connections, we'll definitely make sure that that is operating in an efficient way and as regular as possible. Now, you can have a flight every single day on the jet if the money is available, but sometimes that is very costly. Now, I've had much conversations with the CEO as well as the board in respect to this area, and they will try their endeavor best to plan the scheduling in a way that makes it most efficient and from a cost-benefit perspective that Cayman Brackers have the luxury of these beautiful new planes that we have. But sometimes it's just not enough to fill a jet, so we have to go to the middle-sized jets. I know that there's always the question about more and more flights, but sometimes that costs a lot of money. So the commitment from the Park Administration is that we will continue to make as much flights available for the Cayman Brac community as long as the money is available.
Honourable Cayman Brac West.
Thank you. There has been a review. The Saab aircraft, 34 seats, was right-sizing the fleet for Cayman Brac at the time of the purchase. And there is a thought that is not the right size airplane now. As you've just mentioned, it's hard to go from 34 seats to 160 seats in a time slot. So the review of looking at an ATR or the Dash to put a 50 or 60 seater in the market, that would not come out of this line item. That would be a separate line item that would have to be reviewed. Okay, we would be supportive of that in case you need to bring it back. I guess we can wrap everything together since we're... So, Mr. Minister, if we could go into CAL 2, which would bleed back into CAL 1 as it flows, maybe we could get an understanding of what the requirements and ask is. It's 2022-2023.
I don't remember, it was a question a while ago.
The CAL 2 is in the budget in 2022 for $15,400 change, 2023, $15,435. Just an overview. $15 million, sorry.
So
Honourable Minister of Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. As you can see, as the member highlighted, I just want to make one amendment to the planning estimates. In 2021, it has a number of direct one-way flights per annum was at 4,000 to 5,000. That was just a carryover from the previous year. It's actually 500 to 800 with a guesstimate of 60 to 75,000 persons. This output has to do with the air service, the strategic U.S. and regional gateways identified as key source markets, as like, for instance, Denver, which we'll be bringing back very shortly, which was one of our high output gateways. So it's the standard focus on the U.S. Market, like we were speaking about before, and we have no intentions of shying away from that. Matter of fact, expanding it more. You would have heard me say in my budget contributions that we're considering, obviously having to make sure that the figures and the numbers show a benefit either by way of airline tickets or benefit to the local markets by way of our film industry direction or our continued focus on technology with San Francisco. So you heard we were planning to go to the West Coast, which those new jets will allow us to. So unless there's specific questions to this area, it'll be the main focus as we always done. As I said in my contribution, no need to reinvent the wheel, but just improve it a little better.
Thank you. Member Kieran Rockwest.
Okay, so I can be specific in the question. I thank the minister for that answer. We are extremely fortunate to have Cayman Airways. I believe Cayman Airways has total support from every member in this House. And every day we understand that they're on the front line and what they do and the hundreds of millions of dollars that they've contributed to the economy of this country over a period of time. We're very grateful for that. And the truth is, it's a bragging right for all of us because, as you well know, as you travel, overseas and you talk, people always want to know about how are you able to have an airline like that that's been rated the best airline in the region. So I think it's a fair question considering that we're looking at 2, 3, or 4/8. We don't know if there's been a final decision, but where we are from the standpoint of we no longer have planes that we own, have they been sold? Or are they waiting to be sold? What is the situation with the eights? Are we going to keep two? Are we going to keep three? Are we going to go take the fourth one? And I know some of this is sensitive, but whatever you can share with us, I think it would be very helpful for the country itself, considering that every person here is in theory a shareholder in Cayman Airways.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm going to ask the CEO to give some feedback, and I'm glad that the member asking the question has highlighted that some of this is sensitive. It's still timely, and we want to save as much money as we possibly can. So I know he can give you an update on where we're at with the eights and what planes we're going to finish sell. But there's some areas I think he may be reserved on, so be mindful of that.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give to this honorable government shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. CEO. Good morning, welcome. Just before answering the first question, can you just officially state for the record your name and title, please? Thank you.
Fabian Worms, President and CEO at Cayman Airways Limited.
I think the question, correct me, the member for Cayman Brac West, that's pretty much wanted an overview, an update in terms of CAL2 strategic tourism, regional and core services, which is roughly over almost $31 million over the next for 2022 and 2023. So that's a broad overview, really. Thank you.
Through the chair, the first update shall be on the disposition of the 737-300s that we had retired. The last two remaining aircraft in that fleet and a spare engine that's used to support that fleet were all put to public tender. And we have successfully completed final negotiations in selecting a vendor. We have a contract in place with a deposit, and we are now working on making, we're now working to satisfy the delivery conditions that we need to meet for the purchaser, because their offer was contingent on the aircraft being in certain, being supplied to them in certain configurations and conditions, none of which is overly major. So it's all moving fairly smoothly at this point. And we expect that by the end of this month, the two aircraft would have been delivered and the spare engine would be delivered in January. And there's nothing sensitive about this, but what I can share is that the price that the two assets, the three assets were being sold for is in a region of $2.7 million. And that compares favorably both with our book values as well as current market values. So that's the update on the 737-300 fleet. The 737-8 fleet comprises currently of three aircraft that are in service. A fourth one has been built. It is not yet ready for delivery from Boeing. And the delivery, apart from the status of Boeing's position with respect to where they are, the delivery has to be contingent on us accepting certain terms. And this has to do with the fact that the aircraft is being delivered late, and it is incumbent upon the supplier, which is both the leasing company and Boeing. They both have to make it worth Cayman Airways' while to take an aircraft that is being delivered late. So that part is sensitive, because the actual negotiations won't conclude until the aircraft is actually ready for delivery. And we have not been given any formal notices yet, but we understand that the aircraft will be ready for delivery early in 2022.
Honourable Member for Cayman Brac West.
Thank you. So the 2.7, through you, Minister, to the 2.7 is the gross amount for the total sale of the engine and the two aircraft.
Correct.
And that will go directly to Cayman Airways as cash flow income.
Right.
Will be shown that way.
Right.
Okay.
Working capital.
Okay. So you're going to have to make a decision in early 2022 about the fourth plane. And the other part of this vote that we're going to take in block is Cayman Airways limited equity investment to cover debt servicing and operating expenditure of $18,200,000. Does that recognize the assumption, and if you can't answer it, you can't answer it, but the assumption is that debt servicing, which I'm assuming is lease payments, for three planes or four planes? Because if it's a consideration for your board that it might be four planes, this might not be the right amount.
Through the chair, all our budgetary projections are based on somewhere between the three and the four airplanes, because we were never sure. One thing I should point out about the 9.1 million times two, which would be 18,200,000, is that it represents some movement from CAL 2 by way of a reallocation going to EI 1. The Finance Committee may recall that the last time we visited Finance Committee, it was to have an appropriation where monies were taken from the EI and put into CAL 2 so that we could actually count it as revenues and improve the financial performance of Cayman Airways. What's happened in this instance is that the monies have been put back into EI 1, but you will notice the nomenclature in the annual plan and estimates refers to it as to fund losses. So now we'll have losses, but it will be funded by this EI. So the EI is not just to cover debt, but it is now also to cover the losses that we're projecting. And it's with it will be with the four airplanes.
So through you, Mr. Chairman, so that is to cover losses, not lease payments, but losses on a route, is that what you're saying?
Through the chair, losses at the bottom line, which would be after lease payments are taken into consideration, routes, all of the airline's performance.
Mr. Chairman, I think this may probably help. If you look at the ownership agreement, just on page 63 of the ownership agreement, you'll notice that for Cayman Airways, 12-month budget period 2022 and 12-month budget payment for 2023, we're looking at a loss of roughly $7.16 million for 2022 and roughly $5 million for 2023. So we figure the equity injection of $9.1 million in both years would actually cover in terms of the losses. So it's what would, just to kind of also put your mind at ease in terms of preparing the budget and sign off on the budget, we did invite Cayman Airways in as both the CEO and the CFO, and we went through the results and we compared it not just to 2020, but to 2019, what would have been normal. And what we saw in terms of the benefits is that the fuel efficiency for the plane did help in terms of fuel costs going down overall. And then we also noticed that the revenues went up as a result of having more seats and a more efficient plane. So we were very happy with the metrics and the direction in which the airline was actually trending from that standpoint. Now, we do see Cayman Airways as, while it'd be nice for them to make a profit in the eyes of the government, we see it more as an economic accelerator where the other benefits that it's bring to the market. So one of the conversations that was also entertained is trying to break down between the actual operations of the airline versus the strategic benefits that it provides to the country. So while that is something that we may look at internally, one of the things that we wanted to focus on was to make sure at a minimum that the airline itself was efficient. So there are some services and some routes that it does provide that we know will not break even, but it is an economic enabler for the country, an economic accelerator for the country. So we actually went through Cayman Airways in very great detail because we know that it is, like I said, a loss leader, but the benefits while losing money on paper, the benefits outside to the Cayman Islands as a whole is something that is almost priceless to some extent.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I agree with what you've said, and I thank you for bringing my attention to where some of these answers can be found. Where I was trying to go with this, I think, is very similar to where you're going. You kind of read from the back of the book on me there. We have been last government, a couple different times in Finance Committee, talking about public authorities law and talking about compensation for the employees and the Caymanians that work at Cayman Airways. And our move was to make sure, as if I try to use this in the right way, a person that works at Cayman Airways is compensated in the same way that a person works at the government admin building or whichever building we say. And I know that there was a move afoot by the management of Cayman Airways and the ministry to bring that on par. Right? But if that is going to need more funding to do that, I just wanted to make sure it was reviewed and looked at and the thought process was there, because we would be supportive of continuing with the policy we had started to put in place. And again, with the, especially now, with the number of employees at Cal that were front-facing at that ticket counter and on the ramp, it's a time that we would really support the recognition, and I know your heart's in the right place with it. So that's where I was going to try to understand the funding for it. It seems like it's been considered, and I'm sure you're considering the employees and where they are from a salary standpoint. Because I say for all of us in here, the ability to compensate them for the work they do continues to help us through this economic hard time. The review of the policy of how Cal will implement flights based on requests from the ministry. Is that's well in train, is what I'm hearing?
Honorable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The necessary steps moving forward and how we're going to be handling flights and which ones are selected is going to be based on a approach with the board and the Department of Tourism together, working on which ones are considered to be strategic locations for tourism-related, which may potentially have a loss, as opposed to the traditional ones that are profitable. We're trying to break him anyways into kind of like three parts, but not actually break it into three parts, so we can have a level of accountability, because it is very unfair to the CEO and the management staff of Cayman Airways to always constantly be seen as operating at a loss, when in fact they don't. The principles upon which their goals are set are not based on a profit. It's based on, like the chairman has said, an economic accelerator for our tourism product, as well as to our people in times of emergency. So what we're doing is trying to put them in different buckets. So which ones are constant travel locations that the CEO would make a decision on to say, I would go here because I know I can make a profit. But then the Department of Tourism may say, well, I think I want you to go to this gateway because I know it can bring in, and we start to build on that location slowly but surely until we get it where it's constant amount of people coming in, which you already know. So trying to break that into different parts so that when we look at the accounts, the CEO and his team is not looked upon as a failing company, because the company doesn't operate in the same principles. I think that would answer your question.
Through you, Mr. Chairman. Yeah, thank you, Mr. Minister, for that. I think Denver would be a perfect example of what you've just kind of explained of the partnership with it and how Department of Tourism spent money on marketing it. You know, we agree with that. We certainly do. Can I ask the president, the CEO of the company, to give me his views on the aircraft that would be the next step for right-sizing Cayman BRAC, and with the understanding that the minister's already said that he's looking into this. It'll come under a different line item as far as funding, but he's looking into the Little Cayman situation.
Mr. Chair, if just for clarity before the CEO answers that, I think that I may have mentioned the Saab as opposed to the Twin Otto. But I'm not disagreeing with what your proposal is either. I was saying before in my earlier contribution that we want to eventually get away from the Twin Autos by upgrading the Little Cayman Airport, so rather than having to service three different types of aircrafts, because with three different types of aircrafts, you have three different types of maintenance. But that can't happen until the airport is sorted out in Little Cayman, which we'll start to look to, but it won't happen probably until the next budget when the country's finances are in a different position. But you're also right to say that the current Saab capacity may not be in the perfect lining with the constant travel between Little Cayman. And on that part, I would take the advice from the CEO to offer his thoughts on whether or not we can go down that route of getting a bigger Saab.
Mr. CEO.
Through the chair, the question is what type of aircraft would be the good replacement for the Saabs? And that question cannot be answered until we have completed all of the analysis that would be necessary. There are so many factors that would need to be considered, including what our future plans are going to be with respect to the Little Cayman Airport. There is a lot. So I won't be able to answer that one. But I can give an opinion that what we probably will be looking for is something in the 50-seater class. And as usual, what we would do is, at the end of the day, we will select the best 50-seater aircraft that suits us.
Honorable Member Cameron Brock West.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the CEO for that. The reason I asked the question is because I'm trying to get comfort with the budget for the service that we hope you will deliver. And it seems like we're all heading in the right direction. But I give you the example of, you have 34 seats in the market now, you book 32, and then you have to roll over into another flight 2 hours later, okay? But that flight books at 8, or books at 9, and then a day before it's supposed to fly, they pull the flight, and they move everybody 3 hours later, and you go on an 8 that is put in there at the end of the day. Making it easy and providing the proper air service for Cayman Brac and Little Cayman is one of the ways that they will continue to grow. And I just want to make sure that we have done our work in giving support to government, that you have the tools that's needed to continue to help Cayman Brac and Little Cayman grow. So that's the reason for the question. If the 50-seater is going to throw, in theory you would be running 8 o'clock flights and 5 o'clock flights, and you have enough seats for it. Now with the flights you have, you need to throw another flight in there sometime in the day. Don't be scared to throw the other flight in, please. I say that to the minister as well.
Mr. Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank the member for his statement, I think, more so than a question. And I would like to give him the comfort of knowing that we are on the same page in respect to that. I think was also trying to suggest that we do move forward with that bigger size SAP. It is a commitment of this administration to do so. But you also got to be mindful that we're in a difficult position financially, and that dream may not become a reality until the next budget. But I can promise you that the continued service to Cayman Brac will continue at an efficient rate and as often as possible. Yes, you may be right to say it would have been better if we had the 50 now rather than having to jump between those two SABs twice a day. But we're not in that position. And as soon as the monies are available, that allows us to move in that direction to be more efficient and more profitable for the inter-island travel, we will do so. And I will be happy to work with you and respect that, because I agree with you on your analysis.
Honourable Member Georgetown North.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, to the Minister. Is there any representation here from the Chairman or the Deputy Chairman of the Board?
Through you, Mr. Chair, unfortunately, no member is here.
Okay, sorry. It would have been good to have just heard, you know, from the Board what their view, their policies and insights going forward would be. I know that quite often, sometimes they may not align with the ministry, or we've seen in here where it didn't even align sometimes with the airline. So it would have been nice on such a major budget item to have some representation here. But
I through you, Mr. Chair, thank the member for his question. But I can promise you that the board, the capable board and its members, are in line with the government's position in respect to making sure that Cayman Airways continue to be an economic accelerator, at the same time providing services to the people of this country in respect to emergency services.
Honourable Member Georgetown North.
Happy to hear that, Mr. Chairman. Thank the Minister for the answer. And I did note that he said earlier that they were not reinventing the wheel, but going along with what the overarching policies have been over the last few years. So thank the minister for that.
Honourable Member Cayman Brock West.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to ask the minister, you have discussed and in your debate, you talked about some of the programs that you were going to put in place and reviewing for Cayman Brack and Little Cayman. I'm assuming that part of that will be involving Cayman Airways as well.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Can I ask the member to repeat the first part of the question, please?
The Department of your ministry, I'm assuming in conjunction with Department of Tourism and Cayman Airways, was looking at different initiatives for Cayman Brack and Little Cayman. Example being whether it's a Carifta game over there, whether it's a football match, that type of thing. Are those some of the things that you'll be doing in conjunction with Cal?
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you, Mr. Chair. As you know, as this Honourable Committee knows, Cayman Airways has always been a sponsor in some capacity to any kind of local events in Cayman Brac, because we see the necessity for that. I can say to this Honourable Committee that myself and the Honourable Minister for Sports will be working to help sponsor, even if that's by way of funding or by way of Cayman Airways flights. But we have to ensure that the ministry's intent and goals do not affect the funding for the company Cayman Airways, so they can't take on the debt of what the ministry's responsibilities are. So we'll buy those necessary supporting seats, if necessary, from Cayman Airways in that respect.
So through you, Mr. Chair, groups, people that have ideas for initiatives in Cayman Brac and Little Cayman should contact you.
Correct.
Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions? If not, I'll take the vote. All those in favor of CAL 1 Strategic Domestic Air Services in the amount of $3,134,000 for 2022 and $3,134,000 for 2023, and all those in favor of CAL 2 Strategic Tourism Regional and Core Air Services, $50,435,000 in 2022, $50,435,000 in 2023, and all those in favor is EI1, Cayman Airways Limited, $9,100,000 in 2022, and $9,100,000 in 2023. Please say aye.
Aye.
All those against, no. The ayes have it. Colleagues, we're now moving on to TAB1. Which is
Mr. Chairman, just before you take that, I just want to give apologies on behalf of the chairman, Mr. Jude Scott. He was intending to be here this morning, but unfortunately, an emergency arised, and he was unable to be here.
Okay, thanks much, Minister, for that. Okay, colleagues, with the support of the opposition, we have decided we're going to do TAB 1 through 1, the next four together, so I'll call them out before we open the floor for question. TAB 1, Management of Pedro St. James National Historic Site, $950,000 in 2022, $950,000 in 2023. TAB 2, Management of Queen Elizabeth II Botanic Park, $850,000 in 2022, $850,000 in 2023. TAB 4, Management of the Cayman Islands Craft Market, $140,000 in 2022, $140,000 in 2023. And TAB 5, Management of the Hell Geological Site, $40,000 in 2022 and $40,000 in 2023. Are there any questions?
Mr. Chairman, before any member take questions, I just want to thank the staff from Cayman Airways and ask that they can be excused. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, it's obviously been a difficult time. These tourism attraction board assets were put together for two reasons. One, as we have the flow of incoming tourism, this is part of the attraction process that balances what they do as they are on the island. And then the other part of it is the Pedro site and the Botanic, the offering for local people, the historical value of it, the time sensitive, and areas that allows community to be together. I would just, since we have them all together, maybe we could get a quick snapshot of how the minister feels they're doing, obviously, in a downturn when part of their basic throughput of people has been stopped.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, through you, and I want to thank the elected member for that question and the ability to speak to all of them at once. He's right by saying that, you know, most of this funding is focused on the fact that there will be low numbers, at least for the foreseeable future, and until we slowly start to pick that up, we want to continue to support these amazing entities. In respect to Pedro St. James, as you heard in my contribution, I've been encouraging many different departments and ministries to try to use the location as an option, because it will help fill that gap that is lost from cruise as well as stay over, but hopefully not for too long. Also, highlighting the fact that it's a national historic site, with these sites, there needs to be repairs and the like. Unfortunately, the castle itself is having some faults, and some parts of it is having to be fixed now, and there's monies available in that. I really think that the Ministry of Culture should give me some money in this budget, because we keep it up, but I'll leave that one alone. Moving on now to the Queen Elizabeth Botanic Park. This money is needed now more than ever as a result of Grace has affected it, because you know the park is mainly vegetation, and they had to go through a whole lot while at the same time trying to build a small park for the kids. But it looks like we're going to be able to make it as long as international supplies and labor supplies meet the demands when necessary. In respect to the craft market, you've heard that I've announced that we've purchased a new location on the waterfront just north of Lobster Port at the old... I can't remember the name of the old site, but it's the old Solomon family's residence. We are excited about that location. We've also put some monies in, which I will come to a little bit later, in respect to a waterfront experience capital injection. We intend to have the craft market at that location. I think I may have failed to let in my contributions to announce that, unfortunately, the location at the kernel site where the current craft market is will come to an end at the end of this year. And we want to thank the Kakernal family so much for working with the Cayman Islands government and the people to allow us under a peppercorn lease for that location. And even more reason for the purpose of purchasing the current location that we did. We're in hopes that we can get the site, the new location that we've purchased, up in order, so that in the event of crews coming back a lot quicker and stay over come back quicker, that we have a place for those craft market attendees to be at. So we're working against time, but at the current moment, we don't seem like there's going to be major crews, at least until probably around the end of the first quarter. So hopefully things will be in place, at least for the location for the craft market. And we have other waterfront spots that we can potentially put them if necessary, only if necessary, on a temporary basis until we finish the new park. In respect to the Hell site, another major attraction location, I've been in talks with some of the adjacent landowners, because it's another area that I think we should enhance. Hell has so much to offer. Sorry. The Hell location has so much to offer. We know that the Dome family owns one of the key components of HEL, and I've spoken to them to let them know the government is interested to partner or buying that current location to help enhance the HEL experience, because it's quite like the Stingray City location. I think it's either the second most visited location, or at least in the top five, along with Stingray City. So we want to enhance that, so when we do reopen crews again, that, you know, the people can get what they have been accustomed to in respect to our amazing site. Outside of that, and outside of those matters, the only thing that would eventually in the new budget come under one of probably will end up being a TAB, whatever number in the next budget, would be the new site, because it's intended that this new location, new project, will fall under the responsibility of the Tourism Attraction Board. We want to get it established first for them to take over in management, because it will also be the new site for the craft market.
Honourable Member Georgetown North.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I'm going to ask this question on the. I think it's as relevant here as anywhere else. Maybe I have a solution further down, but have there been any discussions on the Tourism Attraction Board taking over the management of the public beach vendor area?
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Simple answer, Mr. Chair, no. There has been no discussions. The board has not brought it to my attention as something that they were interested in, and I'm happy to consider it. I wasn't aware that there was a thought or interest in doing so, but I'm happy to speak to the member off air and whether what pros and cons he sees as to that, and whether it's something the board would take up.
Honourable Member Georgetown North.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank the Honourable Minister for that response. I think it is going to be or it should be something that you might want to address prior to crews returning, so that we don't go back to the status quo on the public beach, but that we do utilize those huts, even if they have to be retrofitted in some areas. The idea was that the vendors would be located in those huts. I know it's being managed right now by the Public Lands Commission, and then and would then move their chairs or whatever they're renting from that area to the beach as needed, rather than we end up in a situation that we were in for many decades until the pandemic.
Honourable Minister of Tourism.
I think it was a statement by the member, more so than a question. I've taken into consideration what he said and speak with the relevant ministers in respect to whether that's a good option for this administration or not. And I'm happy to speak to him, as I said before, off air.
Mr. Chair. Sorry, Honourable Member for Georgetown West.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Through you, just a simple question. I want to find out if the minister can clarify if the vendors who occupied the space in the craft market originally, will they be given first refusal, even though it'll be a new site? Will they be given first refusal? Why I'm asking is because I've been asked by a few people who are there, were there presently before pre-COVID, and I've been asked by people who are interested in getting booths when it reopens. So we just want to find out if how that will work. Thank you.
A good question. Honourable Member for Tourism, Honourable Minister for Tourism, sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and you're 100% correct. I want to welcome the question by the elected member for Georgetown West. you can, this Honorable House could be happy to know, the Honorable Committee, is that we will be focusing on those persons who are already there, and they will have the first right of refusal to go there. We hope that the site will, or we intend that the site will have at least the same exact number that was there before. Now, because it's a multi-purpose site, meaning a multi-purpose attraction, we can't say that there will be more spots than were available before until we finish the planned project. But I can guarantee you that those who were there before the pandemic hit will have the exact same opportunity to come back.
Any other questions? If not, I'll put it to the vote. All those in favor of TAB 1, management of Pedro St. James National Historic Site, $950,000 2022, $950,000 2023, and TAB 2, management of Queen Elizabeth II Botanic Park, $850,000 2022, $850,000 2023, and TAB 4, management of Cayman and Scruff Market, $140,000 2022, $140,000 2023. And TAB 5, management of the L geological site, $40,000 2022, $40,000 2023. And EI 39, tourism attraction board, $220,000 2022 and $220,000 2023. Please say aye. All those against, no. The ayes have it.
Mr. Chair, I just want to thank the members who are here for the Tourism Attraction Board, and ask that they be allowed to be excused.
Okay, colleagues, we move on now to NGS 1, organize, administer, and execute the Cayman Islands Fishing Tournament, $30,000 2022 and $30,000 2023. Are there any questions?
Mr. Chair, I would like to suggest that
Okay, are there any questions?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, could the member state whether or not we're just looking at this particular line item for the fishing tournament, but we also see TP 67 for 1.8 and 2.3 in 2022 and 2023. They're no way. I mean, they're separate, so this is a separate line item from TP 67. Can the members say when they are planning this the tournament this year? Or next year, rather?
1 second, Mr. Chair. Through you, Mr. Chair, to the member for Deputy Opposition Leader. The tournament normally is in April. Obviously, there's restrictions from a gathering perspective, so we don't know what April will bring, but we want to make sure that money is available in hopes that things are able to facilitate this fishing tournament, as it's an important one to our overall tourism brand and being a Caribbean island. And also to confirm that it always has been a separate line item confirmation for this organization.
Honourable Member Cayman Brock West.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, the Cayman Fishing Tournament, I think, is an opportunity, as the Minister has talked about, partnering with sports for sports tourism. $30,000 is not a whole lot for that tournament, and I don't know if you guys have plans together, because there's some real opportunities there as far as how you use it to market to that high net worth individual. So I'm assuming that you all have a strategy of how you're going to work together with it. Question.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Yes, we will be partnering together. As you heard the Honourable Minister say, sports tourism is going to be a major thing for us. We decided to keep this amount the same because of this particular event. In respect to developing something larger, we would focus those monies coming from the TP from a sponsorship perspective. And I am certain that there's enough monies available within my TP as well as the Minister for Sports TP that collaboratively, if we want to develop something in the next year that COVID will allow, we can find the necessary monies to fund them through that way.
Honourable Member Georgetown North.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Probably more of a statement than anything, but I agree with the member from Cayman Brac West, Cayman Brac Little Cayman West. This is certainly one of those events that we have made efforts over the years to try and return it to $1 million month glory. It is, I've witnessed fishing tournaments in Jamaica and Turks and in BVI rather, and other islands where you would see a tremendous amount of international boats attending. If you actually could attract one of the major fishing teams with international recognition, it would be great. But we did start looking at ways to attract them, and I think it's going to be, or this may be an opportunity, but you will certainly need to look at ways to incentivize those who used to come in to attract even more boats, such as streamlining things with the CBC, Immigration Customs, as well as the very controversial one of duty concessions on the fuel, even if it is just for the boats returning, going back home, for the journey going back home. But these are some of the ideas that we would certainly be supportive of. I would be supportive of. I think it is an event that that we could establish and build into a much larger and much more beneficial event for the country.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to highlight a point that there's no duties on vessels for fuel that are leaving. But I recognize for the fishing itself during the period of time of the tournament, it can be something we can consider. But I, with the support I'm hearing from the Deputy Opposition Leader as well as the former Minister for Tourism, I am willing, if they would support an increase of 100,000 to my TP 67, to try to go back at the $1 million month concept so we can build that. But I'm just scared to ask for it because we've been accused of overspending. But if they're willing to support it.
Mr. Chairman, I think we can cross that bridge when we get to TP67. Because there's $2-4 million there. I'm sure you can find $100,000 out of that to help fishing.
Any other questions for NGS 1? If not, I'll take the vote. All those in favor of NGS 1, organize, administer, and execute the Cayman Islands Fishing Tournament, 30,000 in 2022, 30,000 in 2023, please say aye. All against, no. The ayes have it. Colleagues, moving on to NGS 7, management of small business development in the amount of 311,000 in 2022. And 230,000 in 2023. Are there any questions? Honourable Member for Cayman Brock West and Little Cayman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, just an update. I think it'd be interesting to hear with what we've been through with the pandemic, some of the outreach to small business development.
Honourable Minister.
Mr. Chairman, give me 1 second, please, sir. Through you, Mr. Chair, this line item has to deal with the Land and Sea Co-op. As we know, the Land and Sea Co-op assists many tour operators to facilitate the business with the cruise lines and stayover tourism. And that's been limited, obviously, as a result of lack of crews. But also in that amount is 3 months' worth of the Stingray City Feeding Program, which we knew that would have to continue to be supported until we have enough tourists here, where there's enough trips going to Stingray City, that it goes back to its normal routine.
So, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, $311,000 in 2022 and $230,000 in 2023 goes to the co-op.
Correct, and just the difference between the two is $81,000, which is $27,000 for the next 3 months, January, February, and March, which to deal with the Stingray City Feeding Program. And if you were to take away the Stingray City Feeding Program, you would get $230,000 in 22 and $230,000 in 23 to be the exact amount.
Through you, Mr. Chairman. I would say to the Minister that this is one of the most important line items that he has brought forward for the people who are part of that co-op. And I'm very happy to see that you've continued the Stingray Feeding Program, but the interaction with the boat operators and the needs that they have, considering they haven't been able to use their vessels for years. I'm sure you have an open dialogue with them and continue to make sure that they get help. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
Any other questions related to NGS7? If not, I'll take the vote. All those in favor of NGS7, Management of Small Business Development, in the amount of $311,000 in 2022 and $230,000 in 2023, please say aye. You guys can give me a better eye than that. This is a very important line item. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All those against, no? The ayes have it. Thank you. Colleagues, moving on now to NGS 26, Ms. Cayman Committee, $100,000 in 2022,
$100,000 in 2023.
Are there any questions?
Mr. Chairman.
Honorable Member for West Bay West.
Just to inquire on the minister, if I'm right, seems to be government is supporting two national pageants, Miss Cayman Universe and Miss Cayman World. Am I right? Is that what it's called?
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Through you, Mr. Chair. The member is correct. One is in a bigger scholarship than the other. One is through my ministry and the other one is through scholarship through the Ministry of Education. So yes, the government itself is supporting both.
And so both of them get scholarships?
Correct.
And both of them get administrative funds?
I'm not aware of the other scholarship. The Ministry of Tourism does not offer any other support to the other one that we don't own the franchise for. Their scholarship comes from education, but there's no other funding available.
And so one gets scholarships through tourism and one gets through education. And only one pageant gets administrative funds.
That is correct, sir. Through you, Mr. Chair.
Are there any thoughts, Mr. Chairman, to look at the operations of the other one that we are not assisting, since we're giving them scholarships. That's an assistance, but I'm talking about administrative assistance, to see how we could assist them. And I'd ask the minister to take that on board and look at it.
I do, sir.
Honourable Member Joshua North.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, just looking at the planning estimates, it does seem to signify that both are receiving administration. The description of the administration, organization, and promotion and execution of Miss Cayman Islands pageant, but in the quantity, it has local Miss Cayman beauty pageant arranged for 2022-2023, one each, and representation at an international pageant 2022-2023, or representation. So that's for the same pageant, but okay. All right, great. I read it again and then answered my own question.
Okay, any more questions for NGS 26? If not, I'll take the vote. All those in favor of NGS 26, Ms. Cayman Committee, 100,000 2022, 100,000 2023, please say aye. Those against, no? The ayes have it.
Mr. Chairman, I just want to say, I take this opportunity, as we know, our current reigning Ms. Cayman is away in Israel, and we wish her, on behalf of the whole committee, opposition and government included, the best in her efforts and come back home with happiness and safety, as we know the COVID-19 virus is out there. So we're very, very proud of her, and we're wishing her the best, and hopefully she sees us.
All right, colleagues, thanks very much for that, Minister. Colleagues, moving on to NGS 57, Gardening Projects and Landscaping, 4,000-2022, 4,000-2023. Are there any questions? Honourable Member for Georgetown South.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To the Minister, the Honourable Minister. Gardening Projects and Landscaping. I know this is a small amount, $4,000 for 22 and $4,000 for 23. But can the Honourable Minister indicate what this relates to?
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Through you, Mr. Chair, I'm going to allow my chief officer to give a basic overview, but to say that this is exactly the same amount that was there from the last administration, and we continued the efforts as we did not want to cancel anything the former minister himself had implemented under his ministry.
Honourable, Chief Officer Strang, when we're still on the oath, you may provide the details. Thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, sir. In relation to the question, the output details the thinking for 22-23. So, Mr. Chairman, it will be a major tree planting project to span the 22-23 throughout the island, some locations designated and varying stages of planning already. And then we have ongoing searches for additional locations with the full flower show being planned for 2022. Mr. Chairman, thank you.
Honourable Member West Georgetown South, sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, Honourable Minister, that would include the whole island, or the whole three islands, in terms of the tree planting, and will it actually also involve all of our parks and all of our constituencies?
To answer the question, through you, Mr. Chair, I think this is a collaborative approach with a number of different ministries and a number of different allocations. So obviously we would not leave out Department of Agriculture in respect to this and culture. So this is a part of a bigger plan for planting more trees in the country. And if I'm been reliably informed that this is the Ministry of Tourism's contribution, as you see on the planning estimates on page 194, it highlights all the various different elements, as well as this also tries to help with the Botanic Park, Children's Garden. So it's a collaborative approach from the island's bigger picture with planting more trees. So not specific only to parks, but anywhere that is necessary to be identified.
Honourable Member Georgetown South.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I recognize that the The member for Savannah is heading up the beautification committee. So would they be working in collaboration with that committee in order to plant these trees? But we'll be working together, is my question.
Through you, Mr. Chair, the answer is yes, because this administration works together on all projects, no matter what it is. But this was a separate line item from the beautification output, which I'm glad that you highlighted, which is $500,000 for beautification purposes. So they would work collaboratively together, but this one is focused more on planting of trees more than the cleanup. The other one, the monies available there may focus more on keeping the place clean, doing the necessary research on legislation as well to have a stronger enforcement, because we do not, unfortunately, we have a number of pieces of legislation for littering and, forgive me. The town and town and planning law that mandates that you keep your house and your property in certain order, and many of properties across the island, and sometimes even businesses have not kept their properties in the right order, which carries this derelict kind of approach. We have a severe problem with the vehicles. So that $250,000 per year, a total of $500,000 over the budget period, will not only go into cleanup, but the necessary work that the committee can inform this administration on what we need to do to keep the country beautified, whether that is strengthening our legislation, do a stronger enforcement arm, whether it should be quarterly cleanups, all of these things together. So though, as opposed to this $4,000, which is specific to just tree planting, the other money will cover a little bit of this as well in respect to, it will have the latitude to say, if we want to beautify this area, we can purchase some plants and do so. But this slide item for the $4,000 will be just specific to planting.
Any other questions for NGS 57? If not, I'll take the vote. All those in favor of NGS 57, Gardening Projects and Landscaping, 4,000 in 2022 and 4,000 in 2023, please say aye.
Aye.
All those against, no. The ayes have it. Thank you. Colleagues, moving on now to TP12, Tourism Scholarships, 815,000 in 2022, 815,000 in 2023. Are there any questions? Honorable Member for Georgetown South.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Through you to the Minister. Can the Minister say the tourism scholarships, can he confirm that all of those funds are utilized on an annual basis for scholarships?
Honorable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll ask the CEO to give us a little background. I'm not sure if we used all of it, but I know that maybe not as many kids were going off to school because of the COVID restrictions. So there's a possibility of some savings this term, but I'm assuming things will go back to normal for the next term. And as you would have also heard that I announced that the PAC administration, in support with my colleagues, have agreed that we would allow two pilots scholarships in the range of $60,000, which falls under this as well. But I'll ask the chief officer to give us some background in respect to the funding uses.
Chief Officer Barton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So the minister is absolutely correct. Not all the funds are utilized every year for various reasons. Some students may move to online classes. Some may defer to another semester. Therefore, the funds do not all get utilized. But whoever puts in for the funding that up to the threshold, as Minister has outlined, do get the funds every year, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. Member for West Georgetown South.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To the Honourable Minister again, So for the students going to attending the hospitality school at UCCI, are they eligible then for these scholarships as well?
Through you, Mr. Chairman, the answer to the question is yes.
Any other questions? If not, I'll take.
Thank you.
Member Kieran Brock West and the Cayman. Apologies.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a quick question. If you are in Cayman Brack or Little Cayman and you want a tourism scholarship to come to UCCI, that is available. I'm looking.
Right. As long as you're a Caymanian, you can get the scholarship. I think maybe.
I qualify.
I think the question.
No, but my question is this. There have been a couple of our young people who have missed the date for the scholarship. And now they're going to start in the middle of a term of when they can get a scholarship. So is that something that I should advise them to go ahead and apply for to education and to tourism?
One second, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chairman, the simple answer is that you have to follow the same protocols as the Education Department. But I suspect that the Minister thinks that that's kind of inconvenient for some. And it's something that if it's not, if it can fall within the administrative responsibilities and not become too much of a burden having it throughout the whole year, it's something we're willing to visit. Because yes, persons may start, not always at the start of a year, but maybe in the next semester of spring. So I get the logic, but obviously there's reasons why they keep them within that time frame. There's a level of discipline there as well, which is for young people particularly, that you know you have to get your paperwork in. Otherwise, people will just wait till whenever they want to do it. And the longer you have that administrative window in, the longer the cost for the administration process as well. But I understand what you're saying, and we're willing to see what offerings we can do to facilitate within reason.
Yeah. Through you, Mr. Chairman, thank the Minister for that. I think you, Cayman Brack, you're probably talking about two students, and you're probably talking about somebody who got excited about a tourism career, and the class is not available in Cayman Brack, so they want to come, and they don't want to lose 6 months waiting for the next window. So we can talk offline.
Mr. Chair, the member and I can speak in the break, and I'd be happy to try to facilitate as much as possible.
Well, can I just add one thing to your discussion, because something just occurred to me, listening to the member for Cayman Brack West and Little Cayman. In cases where you're having, like say, a diploma course or a kind of certificate course that would not start in the middle of the traditional school year, or would those things be addressed? Because if that's the case, if you only have a window then, and then you have a certification course or a diploma course outside the normal, I think they need to have some flexibility to deal with those things. So I think that's one of the things from listening to the member kind of caught. I think that needs to be addressed also.
Through you, Mr. Chair, just to confirm that actually those different types of diplomas and courses and degrees have different registration periods. So particularly the Education Department have facilitated, so you want to apply for a degree which starts in September, you apply in this period. For a diploma that starts in the first part of the year, you apply in this period. So it's not like it's inconvenient from a every time, everything is at one time, there's actually allocated registrations for the different programs.
Thank you very much. Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman.
Honorable Member for Minister of Education.
Just a matter of clarification, you know, last year in particular, because of COVID, it came to my attention that these situations were occurring, and so that the whole objective is still, the whole objective, Mr. Chairman, is to ensure that the applicants have equal access to the scholarships. So once there is a good reason, and it's not just the student being lackadaisical or just putting it in before midnight, which has happened with some scholarships, then I directed the education board to extend that period by a month. So that's an option that's available as well.
Okay. Now, there's another question on TP12, tourism scholarships. Honourable Member Joshua North.
Mr. Chairman, I think we're okay if you want to take the vote on 12 and 13.
Okay. I'll put to the vote. Thanks, Honourable Deputy Leader of Opposition. We take TP12 and TP13 together. So all those in favour of TP12, tourism scholarship, 815,000 in 2022. And 815,000 in 2023. And all those in favor of TP13, Ms. Cayman Scholarship, send the 5,000 in 2022 and send the 5,000 in 2023. Please say aye.
Aye.
All against, no? The ayes have it. Next item, colleagues, is TP67, Sports and Cultural Tourism Programs Assistant, 1,850,000 in 2022, 2,350,000 in 2023. Are there any questions? Honourable Member for Cayman Brock West and Little Cayman.
Thank you. Before the $100,000 conversation comes up, Mr. Chairman, could the Minister give us an outline of what these are going to be spent on?
Through you, Mr. Chair, this allocation covers the what you heard me announce in my contribution, the amount of $1.5 million for the Film Commission rebate that we're trying to build the film industry. Also, that will cover the $250,000 for the Beautification Committee. One second, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Chair, and through you again, and the balance would be the standard amount that would be there as per other budgets before under the former minister for your regular TP appropriations for sponsorships and the like. Like say, for instance, when they want to go to Kim and Brack and they're asking for assistance for jet skis and the like, this is where the money comes from.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Could the minister get into a little bit more detail on the $1.5 million dollar rebate for films? I appreciate we don't have taxation or taxes to refund. So I'm just wondering how this would be done, and whether with it being a line item here, this is going to be an assessment where a check is then given to the film company at the end of their period, or how will we achieve this?
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and very timely question. The plan is pretty simple. We have to do a report on. First off, let me say the fact is that this money is not given back to a film or company until after they've done the film. We'll probably do an audit of what they've spent and how that's direct spend within the economy. Hence the reason you heard me announce the Film Commission, which will be analyzing what model we would use, how would we determine what we are willing to say considered to be a rebate or not. So for example, trickle-down spend couldn't be calculated, but direct spend, as to say, for instance, a person stayed in a hotel room, we wouldn't have made that money off the room and board, or are they arrivals in respect to the flights. So we have to determine that, and I'll be working closely with the Minister of Finance to find out what model we would be happy to accept. So once that model is figured out, then we can say, okay, as per the spend that they spent in the community, whether it's 10 million, 7 million out of that has been direct spend. And that 7 million we will take, say for instance, 20% of that, and then give them a rebate on that amount. So they have to spend the money up front, do the analysis, and after the analysis is done, we determine and agree together, and that's where this amount would come from. Now, I personally believe that this amount is going to be a small sum, but we are willing to come back to ask for the opposition support. If in fact we get that many films or that large, a film that is that large spends that amount. So if you were just to take the standard average rebate in film of 20%, this would be a film for $10 million, not 10 million, 5 million. Yeah, $5 million or just over, which is not necessarily a very large film. But if necessary, we can use the $1.5 million from the 2023 amount, and if necessary, come out to this Honorable House to ask for assistance. But that's the basic plan, and we'll definitely update Parliament as soon as we have a better formulated structure upon which how we're going to manage the rebate program for the film industry.
Honourable Member for Redbay.
Chairman, I'm happy to give it to Mr. Hugh.
Honourable Member for Joshua North.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a follow up on that, and I did spend quite a bit of time working within the Film Commission and with the film industry locally and overseas. And at that time, when it was considered, they felt that most of the filmmakers I spoke to felt that the tax rebate, as they called it, wasn't so much of an incentive. In most countries, it was so burdensome to put in an application for it, and even when they did do that, it took many, many, many years sometimes to see any monies returned. But what was burdensome for Cayman was dealing with work permits, how long the persons can stay on island, duties, if you go back to Kabu, for instance, every time they took a guitar out of the container, the customs had to be there to record it and put the guitar back in. Customs had to be there to record it. It gets a bit cumbersome, and those were the issues that we really struggled with. And of course, the anti-paparazzi law as well, when it came to attracting major stars, the absence of one was an issue. We do have the immigration laws and other laws that basically act as anti-paparazzi, because persons would have to apply for a work permit to come in as a journalist, and then we could screen them to see whether they are, what type of journalist mainstream, or whether it's a propaganda magazine or whatever. But the movie stars do feel more comfortable coming to a jurisdiction that gives them some recourse in that jurisdiction as far as dealing with paparazzis. So I offer my full support to the film industry. I was a huge supporter in reviving the Film Commission and bringing in the K Film, which started out to be look like it was going to be a significant event for us annually. So I do support this. I just have difficulty dealing with the concept at this time. But just I'm happy. And again, you've offered the member from Kimmerbrack and Little Cayman West, opportunities to collaborate. I certainly have no issues in sharing what the thought process was prior and what our visions were on this.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I want to thank the member for the comments, and I agree with him. What's going to be the success of this industry is not only the rebate, but the efficiency. That means working collaboratively with other ministries, from CVC to actually the same minister for immigration purposes, and whatever is necessary, because film is all about time and how quickly can you get things done. They run on a very tight schedule. So that's the main reason, that's one of the main things that the new film commission, once appointed, will have to address is how, what is the best ways to be efficient, which are the departments that we have to work with to get that done. So I'm committed to that, and that's going to be one of the top priorities in the first part of the new year after Christmas.
Honourable Member Redbay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I wonder if the minister could explain the entry on page 195 of the planning estimates, the 12-month forecast for 2021 is for, this is under sports and cultural tourism programs assistance, is $63,814,259, whereas the estimates for next year are only 1,850,000, and for 2023, 2,350,000.
Minister for Tourism.
Thank
you. Chairman, before you get to that, allow me, as I have to leave the chamber, just allow me to record my thanks and appreciation to Ms. Rosa and her team for her assistance in this past year, as whenever we ask her to do anything or get anything for us, help us with anything as a representative, as an MP, she is always most willing to give and to help wherever she can. Thank you very much, Mr.
Thank you, Honourable Member for West Chairman. West. Honourable Minister for Tourism, responding to the Honourable Member for Redbay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To the member's question, that amount included the stipends to the recipients. That's for the whole of this year. That's why it's budgeted that way, or for outlined in that way. All the supplementaries we came to Parliament for was outlined in that, for the displaced tourism stipend recipients.
Honourable Member Redbay.
Mr. Chairman, I thank the minister, and I had come to the conclusion that that must be what it is. But because of that, I find it somewhat alarming that that the government is only proposing 1,850,000 for 2022, compared to 63 million, almost 64 million in 2021. Now, either someone is hoping there's going to be, or projecting it's going to be a marvelous recovery of the tourism industry starting in January, or that amount is hugely under budgeted.
Honourable Member Redbay, it's actually budgeted elsewhere, but I will take it in anticipation that you will support that vote when it comes up, but it's budgeted elsewhere.
Okay, yes.
Yeah.
$2,500 a month, right?
We good. Mr. Chair, as you said, that the amount, you see, the member for Redbay was paying close attention to my contribution in Parliament, he would have heard that the stipend recipients process and payments would be transferred to the Ministry of Finance. But maybe he wasn't in the chamber at that time, because it's been late quite often recently. But
Mr. Chairman, I did hear that, but there is no explanation here for the huge difference between this. It doesn't say stipend, it simply says sports and cultural tourism programs assistance. That's all it says.
I know that Honourable Member Redbay, and you are correct, because, I mean, when we came into the office and we saw that number too, we were a little bit surprised too, but then we were told last year it was booked for the displaced tourism workers. So, but it is, but it's elsewhere, but your point is well noted.
So, Mr. Chairman, you're taking over responsibility for this now?
It will fall under one of my ministers, correct?
All right, sir.
Honourable Member for Georgetown North.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I think the minister said that there's about 150,000 in a beautification, 250,000. Mr. Chairman, as the former minister responsible for Public Works and Parks. Will there be additional funds in that ministry for the upkeep and maintenance of all of these beautification efforts? There are going to be several. I know that there's going to be, I think there's going to be a couple line items for beautification projects or beautification things. And I assume that this will include vegetation, plants, et cetera. And this has been, I'm not playing, being smart here, Mr. Chairman, this has been a challenge for us. It's fantastic to build all these parks and to do all the beautification. I support it 100%. But I want to know whether or not there are other line items for the upkeep and maintenance of these beautification projects, or they're included in each line item.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Relevant question. The maintenance would fall under the minister responsible for parks, and I'm assuming that question could be asked at that point for your relevant answers.
Just for the record, Honourable Member for Georgetown North, under the panel PH4, Public Parks and Cemeteries Maintenance and Management, there is over $2.1 million budgeted for 2022 and $2.2 million budgeted for 2023 also. So, yeah, that would be under planning. So there are other funds budgeted elsewhere.
Yeah, we'll wait until we get, Mr. Chairman, thank you for that. We'll have a look at it when we get there. What I want to ensure is that there should have been additional funding budgeted for the maintenance of some of the road corridors that we have somehow inherited recently, and as well as all of the new parks that were under construction or being constructed. And the fact that we took back over the parks from the DART organization last year. So when we get there, we'll have a look at it, but I want to make sure that there's adequate funding for that department to do or to carry out the services they already carry out, plus the additional that have fallen upon us over the last year, year and a half, and what is coming.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions with regard to TP67, Sports and Cultural Tourism Programs Assistance. Honourable Member Kieran Brackwest and Little Cayman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, this is $1,850,000, $2,350,000. The minister has identified $1.5 million and $250,000. It leaves $2,500,000. Which I don't think is, my understanding is that if you have an opportunity and you have to have a vision and some funds somewhere to take advantage of it, to do something that has a positive result and a good ROI for the country, you have to be in a position. Assuming that's what this $2.5 million is parked there for, is there a vision of how it will be spent and what opportunities you think may arise?
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The member broke down the total amounts for 22 and 23. Are you talking about which part of the spend? Because unfortunately, I have to clarify something, Mr. Chair. The first year for the Film Commission is only $1 million. The second year in 2023 will be $1.5 million, which is a total of $2.5 million for the film. And then the $250,000 would be on both years, which would leave over the $600,000, which would normally be in the TP, which you're aware of. Which one specifically are you talking about? Are you talking about the overall plan for spend?
Well, if I use the example that we discussed before, you said if I could get another $100,000 on my TP, then I could give it to the Fishing Association, right? But I just use that as an example. That's your vision, right? And you don't know whether the opportunity is going to be there, because somebody would come and say, Minister,
There's a good ROI on this for tourism, for the country itself. Is this something that you're interested in doing? And you analyze it and you say, yes, or we can split, or we can do 50 or whatever. So my question is, do you have other opportunities that you believe are going to become available for you, for the country, that you have this available for?
Well, the amount of $600,000 that has been allocated there has been allowed to, of course I would want it increased, but subject to the finances that are available. So I'm happy that my colleagues at least allowed me to keep it to where it was before, which is our traditional sporting events and sponsorship events that we would do. Now, whether all of them will move forward or not, we'll juggle that to say, for instance, if we find savings one place and we find a new venture that we want to go down, like say, for instance, that $1 million month with the fishing experience, we can pull from the next year. And then if necessary, find savings within each ministry and ask my colleagues to support me in that respect. So you know the act of juggling the money, if necessary, when it comes forward. But it would be unfair to my colleagues to ask for any more with the limitations. And we saw within the budget debate the very serious concerns about how much spending we're doing. So I'm appreciative for this amount. I'll have to make do with what is there and try to do more with less. So at the very least, this is what was there before when you were in office. So I'm quite sure I can do just as good, if not better, with the same amount.
Interesting. So what I understand is then there are funds available if somebody makes a case for some type of opportunity in Cayman Brac or Little Cayman.
Yes.
Good.
And other questions with regards to TP 67? If not, I'll put it to the vote. All those in favor of TP 67, Sports and Cultural Tourism Programs Assistant, $1,850,000 in 2022, $2,350,000 in 2023, please say aye.
Aye.
All those against say no. The ayes have it. Colleagues, my next item is OE 91, Depreciation of Ministry of Tourism and Transport Executive Assets, $5,000 in 2022, $5,000 in 2023. Are there any questions? Now we put it to the vote. All those in favor of OE 91, Depreciation of Ministry of Tourism and Transport Executive Assets, $5,000 in 2022, $5,000 in 2023, please say aye. All those against, no. The ayes have it. Next item, colleagues, is EI 49, Cayman Turtle Conservation and Education Center Limited, $2.5 million in 2022, $2.5 million in 2023. Are there any questions? Honourable Member for Cayman Brac West and Little Cayman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, just asked the Minister if he could give us an update on the turtle farm itself, and it's a very important anchor to tourism in the West Bay area for sure.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We do have one of the chief heads at the turtle farm here. And to give a better comprehensive outlook of it, I'll ask one of them to step forward to speak to it.
I've been right on. And you can repeat any one of these. Are you comfortable with
it? I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give to this honorable parliament shall be truth and the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. At the start of your first response, can you just enter your name and title for the record, please, before answering the first question? Thank you.
I'd like to thank everybody for the opportunity to share. My name is Sean Glidden. I'm the finance manager of the Cayman Turtle Conservation and Education Center. and I will do my best to answer your questions. Right now, just as a quick update, for the years that we are in operation, we were looking to do the same as projected by the ministry in the tourism area. We are looking to do the 40% and the 70% as noted previously with other departments. We're hoping to have the cruise tourism back as one of that being our one of our main staples of revenue, one of our main revenue streams. And we're also looking at avenues to diversify on our revenue while we have been, it's still in operation. Those areas, we were expecting that tourism will be back in the near future. And so with tourism, the tourism area, we are working steadfast to come up with new innovative ways to diversify our revenue streams.
Honourable Member Cayman Brack West and Little Cayman.
Mr. Chairman, I want to take the opportunity on behalf of the opposition to thank Mr. Glidden for being here this morning and to tell him how important we believe the Turtle Center is and the perseverance that you've had through this pandemic to be there every day and to keep the doors open and to give people the opportunity. And most importantly, the anchor that it creates for the West Bay area especially and the opportunity that we see that it will come back and that it'll give the same people that were there before. And I'm sure one of my colleagues will ask the question about the employees there, that they continue to work, they continue to be paid, and they're in a position to accept the growing tourism as it starts coming. That's a question.
Mr. Glidden?
So to answer your question, through you, Mr. Chairman, we are working on maintaining the staff with the movement now. I believe that we will be going to the POCS pay scale, and so that should be assisting the staff in maintaining our, if I'm answering the question correctly for you, sir, is that we are going to be moving to the pay scale of the civil servants as well, sir. That's, if I understood your question correctly, sir.
So the, through you, Mr. Chairman, thank you. So Mr. Glidden, just to make sure that you're good, the $2.5 million covers your operational expense.
No, sir. The $2.5 million that we will have for equity injections projected for the next 2 years will not cover the operating expenditures. It has been agreed upon that we will be taking on a $10 million loan that would help with the operating expenditures.
So what would your bottom line be? That's $5 million a year plus $2.75 million a year?
Mr. Chair, just to help support, the drawdown for that loan would be $8.8 million in the first 2022 and $1.2 million basically in 2023, assisted with the injection of the $2.5 million per year each year will get them up to par, because the thinking is by 2023 things should be back to where it should be, that they can help facilitate for themselves. So if you put the calculation of the $8.8 million plus the $2.5 million, you get over $10 million for 2022. And then if you do the $1.2 million plus the $2.5 million in 2023, because they're going to be doing a lot better, it's a smaller number, it's only $3.7 million, but by then their revenues should be a lot higher in 2023. Does that make sense?
Makes sense how you explain it. My concern is that it's going to be $10 million for the operation, so you're going to, there's no capital expense
in this at all. It's a loan to fund operational expense, and it's going to be $10 million for 2022.
So I think it's more a loan to fund the operations of the Turtle Center. I think that's pretty much it, because when we looked at what they wanted to do, we looked at their cash flows, and then we considered the law, which actually requires them to make a profit. We decided, because right now they're running on an overdraft, and we decided it was actually better off for the country, since the government had excess cash, to actually convert the overdraft into a loan, charge them no interest for the next 2 years, plus also give them additional lending for what it is that they want to do for their day-to-day operations, which include both operational and capital, plus also make an equity injection. So not just operational expense, but rather the operations of the Turtle Center. So that is more, and in terms of what defines operations, that is something that's going to be driven more by the board than anything else. So when they came in and made their presentations to caucus, as we were going through the budget and we looked at what their plans were, that's one of the things that we look at. But just to, as I said before, in my contributions, is that when you look at the Turtle Center also, and there was a time when the subsidy used to be $10 million per year. When you look at it, $6 million of that went towards a loan which no longer exists, and $4 million would have been their normal subsidy. But then you look at the Turtle Center having employed almost 100 staff directly, another 500 indirectly, and then having an attraction that does over 200,000 people per year. The question is then, where else could you get roughly 600 people employed, over 200,000 visitors for $4 million a year as a big part of our tourism product? So it was still in long in those veins based on what it is that they expressed to us during their budget presentation, why we came up with the numbers that we wanted in terms of what would have been for their operations as they would need it, because it does include some capital, and also what it is that they would need as a shortfall. So when we looked at both years, that's how the $10 million loan got broken up between $8.8 million in 1 year, because we expect activity to be lessened versus the revenues as it would improve in 2023, how much it will actually need. And then we made a normal equity injection that will also to help in terms of their, the equity injection for us is more to kind of really help, if anything, on the capital side as opposed to the operational side. And the loan, if anything, is more to fund them more on the operational side than anything else. So that was pretty much the mindset after they came in and made a presentation in terms of what it is that they wanted. And then that's how we looked at it based on the presentation that was made to the board. Well, sorry, made to caucus based on the budget that was put together by the board or approved by the board. So that's where we came. But what we didn't want is for them to go outside and basically borrow the money to stay alive. So that was pretty much how those funds came up.
Mr. Chairman, we're in total agreement with you. The way that the government looks at Turtle Farm is the same way, Turtle Center, excuse me, is the same way we viewed it. And the most important part for us is to make sure that the employees are taken care of, satisfied, and know that they have a job this year, next year, as Turtle Center grows. The only question we're asking is, you're satisfied, obviously, that this is the funding they need, and you have one part of it, the operational side, and the salary side of it. You're not identifying any capital, but as you ramp up your arrivals and your business, you believe that the money that's been allocated will make it fit for purpose when it needs to serve us as a tourism attraction.
Is that question to me or to the chairman?
If you can answer, that'd be good. I hope it's...
To follow the footsteps of my good chairman and finance minister, yes.
Thank you, sir.
And just on a separate note, I really want to thank the member for Cayman Brack West and Little Cayman for the concern he raised with the staff, because it is also for us a very big issue in terms of the staff to make sure that they're properly compensated and everything else. So that's one of the reasons why over the next 2 years, we're looking at roughly $15 million being injected into the Turtle Farm as both borrowing and also via capital. And they have savings from, again, not paying the interest, because the interest payment alone would have been like $500,000 over the next 2 years. And again, by us lending the money, that's money they actually save to do actually more. So that's what we looked at. Any other questions with regards to EI-49? If not, I'll put it to the vote. All those in favor of EI 49 Cayman Turtle Conservation and Education Center Limited, 2.5 million in 2022, 2.5 million in 2023, please say aye.
Aye.
All those against, no. The ayes have it. And colleagues, last item for the Ministry of Tourism and Transport, EA 159 Waterfront Tourism Experience, 1 million in 2022, and 560,000 in 2023. Are there any questions? Honourable Member for Red Bay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I wonder if the Minister could explain whether this relates to the property he explained to us the government has just bought or in the process of buying, I'm not sure which, just north of the Catboat Club there.
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, the member is correct, yes.
And Mr. Chairman, is this the purchase price of the property?
No, sir. I'll get the exact purchase price for you, unfortunately. Matter of fact, I think you'd be best suited that you ask that to the lands minister when that appropriate time.
Ah, that's where it is?
Yes.
Okay. And so, Mr. Chairman, I accept that. So the 1 million for this year, for next year, and 560,000 for the following year are operational costs?
No, sir. The amounts there is for the remodeling and to bring it up to par, to opening it. We think that would be sufficient enough to get the location to where it's at, along with assistance to the Tourism Attraction Board, which you will eventually become a part of. We think the location and the offerings that will be supported by the Department of Tourism will have it in a way that it can sustain itself with its own revenues, because there's so much chatter about what that location can offer. So that amount plus the following year is more so to get it to where we want it to be with to operate financially.
Okay, thank you.
Honourable Member Georgetown North.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Could the member please let us know when they anticipate this the facilities to be open?
Honourable Minister for Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. As I said to my very, very capable chief officer, that it has to be done by the middle of this year, of next year. I'm already in 2022. Of next year, but as you all members on the opposition side who've been a part of government know, sometimes things go a little bit slower than necessary. But I can promise you that I'll be putting the necessary pressures on to try to get it developed. But I'm so happy to hear that you guys are in support of this project, because I really believe, not only for the PAC administration, but for the country as a whole, this location is something that the people can be proud of. And I really look forward to inviting all members, including the opposition, to be there in celebration as we cut that ribbon together, because I think this project can be something special.
Honourable Member Joshua Mark.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank the Honourable Member for his answer. Can the Honourable Member tell us where the operational funding, where in the budget will the operational funding be held? And I anticipate that it is intended to be a non-for-profit, and having some understanding of what it takes to operate a food and beverage facility, I anticipate it will be a substantial operation budget.
Thank you. To you, Mr. Chair, as I said before to the answer to the member from Red Bay, we believe that the necessary monies that are there will be able to get it up and running, and in collaboration under the Tourism Attraction Board, that once it's set up, that there'll be enough business for the revenues to help it continue to operate, because it will fall on the Tourism Attraction Board eventually, once we've gotten the final paperwork done. The government, my latest update was that we have finally, what's the close date? They have already, the former owners have received the tract, and it will be in our hands. I think it's supposed to be this week, actually. And once that's in our hands, that money is to try to get it up to par and then transfer it over
to Tourism Attraction Board with it having enough things for it to operate. And once it starts to operate, the revenues come in and keep it operating on its own.
Honourable Member Josh Onnart.
Thank the Honourable Member Minister for that response. So let me understand this. The operational budget will be in TAB1 or TAB, well, as Pedro St. James, TAB4, TAB5, HEL. That's what I'm wondering, and if the minister believes that it'll be open second, third quarter 2022, then I would assume that the 2023 560,000 is operational.
Mr. Chair, before I ask the good member, I would like to thank the staff at the Turtle Center for coming in and ask that they be excused. To answer the Deputy Opposition Leader's question, maybe I forgot one key principle to this model, which was to put out to tender the actual restaurant itself. And that way, the revenues will be able to self-sustain it, as well as we would make revenue off of the rental. Because the rest of the property is where the cost that will be, in our view, smaller that we would have to deal with, which is just upkeep of the craft market area, the bathroom facilities, not all the assets you need, whether it's buying cooked foods and goods and lights and services, employees, salaries and all that. So the intention was that, and it's still being developed as we speak, to tender it out to a company that is willing to operate, but at the same time train Caymanians. And one of the principles agreements is that you have to hire Caymanians on a training program. So ideally, it would be great to find a school that trains people who are willing to operate a restaurant that is going to be very profitable, in my humble opinion, because it has the support of the Cayman government behind it.
Honourable Member Josh Onnart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I thank the Honourable Minister for explaining that, and I admire his enthusiasm and certainly would support anything that advances our people, and in particular in the hospitality industry, which I spent most of my life in, and in my constituency. But I can tell you it's not that easy to make money in a food and beverage establishment whilst training people. However, I do believe that there's some more thought that needs to be put into this going forward. And I would just say to the member as well that I would be considerate of the timing when it comes to what is being perceived by some in the industry as a government competing with those who have been struggling on the waterfront to stay open for the last year and a half. But I do share in his enthusiasm. I just feel that there's still a lot more questions. More answers than there are questions to be answered as far as I'm concerned, but we shall watch it and see. Thank you.
What I can see, Honorable Deputy Leader of Opposition, once the plans are finalized, I will implore upon the minister to provide yourself as the representative for the Joshua North area of plans, and also to your fellow colleagues to give an update as to what is planned. But based on what the minister said with regards to tendering it, more than likely it's something that's going to be run by a private establishment. The government is more interested in ensuring that the people that came in as at least own a little bit of real estate on the waterfront and at least enhance the tourism experience. But it's not about competing with the private sector. It's more about adding something to our tourism product on the waterfront.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I share with you in that, and you know, I'm very happy that the property within my constituency has been secured. These are things for consideration. Perhaps the Honourable Minister may want to consider working with the Cayman Islands Tourism Association. Perhaps they could actually operate it in partnership with the government of the training center, and any revenues from that could go towards supporting the operations of the Cayman Islands Tourism Association. Just one suggestion, but I appreciate your offer, and we look forward to
it. Honourable Minister of Tourism.
Sorry, Mr. Chairman, did I just hear the Deputy Member of Opposition say to give this property or this business to CETA? Did I hear you correctly saying that?
Sorry, Mr. Chairman, through you. I didn't say to give it to CETA. I said perhaps the Minister may consider the operations of the training facility in partnership with CETA.
I apologize, Mr. Chair, but through you, the reason why we're even considering this in the first place is because the previous operations with CETA didn't work. We have a hospitality school at the university that every time we get people trained there, under their stewardship of members from CETA, when the persons are graduated, they still can't get into the industry. So much so, we have to consider creating an environment where they can learn on the job as well as from a certification perspective. That's the whole concept of this. So forgive me for my response in that respect. But yes, they can be in collaboration with what is necessary to be listed, but CETA carrying it out, and when I say CETA, I don't mean as a whole organization, but my confidence in them running it is just let me rephrase that. Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I don't want to throw out the baby with the bathwash here, because it's not all members of CETA. Matter of fact, 95% of them worked well with the ministry. But at this particular tenure, I don't think that that's what we're trying to go with. What we're trying to go with is say, listen, please tell us what you think they should have, and we'll deal with it. We could say that they have been certified from a academic perspective, as well as in-house training. Because once we do this project moving forward, we will no longer accept businesses that say, first off, you need to train. And when we train them, then they say, well, they don't have any experience. So that's what has been happening. And we've had the studies to show how many people have gone through the hospitality training school and still can't get a job in the industry. So now this project hopefully will cover both areas, so they no longer have any excuses once they finish through this program. And I think it's something that the former Minister of Tourism is well aware of in respect to this. So forgive me for my response about the CETA, or particular members of CETA.
All right, no other questions. I'll put it to the vote. All those in favor of EA 159, Waterfront Tourism Experience, $1 million in 2022, $560,000 in 2023, please say aye. All those against, no? The ayes have it. Colleagues, that concludes the appropriations to the Minister of Tourism and Transport. We will take our, I understand the Minister probably want to say something before.
Yes. Mr. Chairman, I want to say thank you first off for allowing the process for questioning. I want to thank all the staff of the various different departments, as well as my ministry and government-owned companies who came in and gave evidence today, some that didn't even need to be here due to the fact that there was no specific appropriations, but I made sure that they arrived just in case there's any questions. So I want to say thank you so much to them. I want to say thank you so much to my finance team within the ministry. Have been working really, really hard, keeping me abreast of where we are in respect to our financial position. So with that being said, I want to get permission to allow them to leave now that we're completed, and thank this honorable committee for their support of the numbers in this bill. Loan.
All right, thank you very much, colleagues. We will take a break now and we'll resume at 2:00. Thank you.